Hello everyone, a very good morning to all. So in this video we'll be discussing about oxoacids of halogens. So these are the oxoacids which are known for the halogen compounds. So oxoacids of halogens have the halogens atoms in their plus one oxidation state, which will be called as hypohalous acids. They will have the halogens in plus three oxidation state. For plus three oxidation state, only one oxoacid is possible, that is, which is for chlorine, that is chlorous acid, and those compounds are called as halous acids. And in plus five oxidation state, there will be halic acids, and in plus seven, they will be called as perhalic acid. So if we talk about chlorine, as for chlorine, all the haloacids, all the oxoacids are possible. So in plus one, it will be hypochlorous acid. In plus three, it will be chlorous acid. In plus five, it will be chloric acid. And in plus seven, it will be perchloric acid. So only for fluorine, only one oxoacid is possible, that is hypofluorous acid. So that is where fluorine is in its, it should be in plus one oxidation state based upon the formula, but there is an exception that in this particular case, because fluorine is more electronegative than the oxygen, as other halogens are less electronegative than oxygen. So this case is having the exception that fluorine is having minus one oxidation state, and oxygen is in its zero oxidation state, and hydrogen serve as plus one oxidation state. So the formula becomes HOF. It is a white solid which is prepared by the reaction of fluorine with water, and we get this solid which melts at minus 117 degrees Celsius to a pale yellow liquid. So this is called as hypofluorous acid, and this is the only acid known for fluorine, wherein fluorine is not in plus one but in minus one oxidation state. So if we talk about the basic structure of these oxoacids, let us have a look at the tricks to memorize these acids, the structure of these acids. Firstly, we'll have this chloric acid. The formula for chloric acid is HClO3. So for all the oxoacids of halogens, they must have this OH group. One OH group must be there. Geometry is always tetrahedral, that is the sum of bond pairs and lone pairs is going to be 4. So shape will vary based upon the number of lone pairs and number of bond pairs. So basicity is always 1, because as number of OH groups is always 1, so basicity will always 1. So firstly, let us start from this chloric acid. So chloric acid, the formula is HClO3. So if we add, it is having chlorine atom in the center, a center atom, one lone pair with two doubly bonded oxygens and one OH group. That is how it becomes HClO3, because there is only one hydrogen, so one OH is going to be present there. Now, if we add one oxygen, it will become perchloric acid. Here we are, the only exception is there, it is not giving its peroxo. Peroxo linkage is not here. So one oxygen which has been added will be attached to chlorine as doubly bonded oxygen, not as a peroxide linkage. So here it is attaching here as a doubly bonded oxygen. It will replace the lone pair. So the formula is going to become HClO4, which is for perchloric acid. Here oxidation state becomes plus 7. In chloric acid, it was plus 5. Hybridization in all these acids is sp3. Shape is varying. Here the shape is tetrahedral. Here the shape is pyramidal, because one of the position is occupied by the lone pair. Now, if we want to convert chloric into chlorous, what we'll do is we'll remove one of the oxygen, and the oxygen which is going to be removed is going to be the doubly bonded oxygen. So two lone pairs are going to be there, one doubly bonded oxygen and one OH group. So the shape is going to be angular or bent, and hybridization is going to be the same, that is sp3. So it will give it the suffix by replacing, it will here the suffix will come us, O-U-S, which will replace the suffix IC, that is 8. Now, if we remove one more oxygen, a prefix will get introduced here, that is hypo, and we remove one more oxygen. Again, the doubly bonded oxygen will be removed, because if we remove the oxygen from here, it will no longer remain as an acid. So the formula is going to become XOH, or we can say ClOH for hypochlorous acid. So yes, we have removed one of the oxygen, which was doubly bonded. There will be three lone pairs and one OH group on the chlorine. So oxidation state for chlorine is plus one, and rest of the things are same shape. Whenever we have two molecules, then we cannot decide about the shape. So we can say it's linear. We cannot say actually, because it's a bond between two of the two entities. So yes, the basicity is again one, oxidation state is one, and hybridization is again sp3. So hybridization is fixed here, that is sp3 for all the oxo acids of halogen. Now we'll be discussing them one by one. Firstly we are taking up hypohalous acid. So it is prepared by shaking freshly prepared mercuric oxide in water and halogen. So what we do is we take mercuric oxide, which is freshly prepared, we shake them in this solution, and we'll get the formation of this HgOHX2, which is going to precipitate out. And along with that, we'll get the formation of HOX, which is hypohalous acid. So these hypohalous acids of chlorine, bromine, and iodine, these exist in solution form and they are highly reactive. And most stable among these is the chlorine. And this is the most stronger acid. Now, the acidic strength of these depends upon the electronegativity. More the electronegativity of the central atom, more is going to be the acidic strength. Now, if we talk about how the electronegativity is playing the role in deciding the acidic strength, it is how that if we have this chlorine to OH bond. Here it is chlorine and here it is OH. Now, what the electronegativity is going to play is that if this atom, this chlorine atom, is electronegative, say we take here as X, not chlorine. Okay, so let me draw X here. So X here is, if it is more electronegative, what it will do, it will extract out electron density from oxygen and it will make the release of a hydrogen easy. That means acidic strength is more if electronegativity is more. Now electronegativity of halogens decreases down the group. So we can say that its acidic strength is decreasing down the group. So that is how it is dependent upon the acidic strength. Now the thermal stability is also decreasing down the group because size of the central atom is increasing down the group. So as the size is increasing, the bond between the halogen and the oxygen is getting more and more weak. So that is why thermal stability is decreasing as we are moving down the group. So the corresponding salts for these oxo acids are called as hypohalites. So solution of hypohalites can be made by disproportionation of the halogens in cold alkaline solution. What we do is we treat these halogens with the cold alkaline solutions. We'll get the formation of this OX negative, that is hypohalite solution, the corresponding hypohalite of that particular salt, that particular metal of which we have taken the alkali. So this further, as the temperature rises, this further disproportionate to the corresponding halide and halate. So this is hypohalite. So it will give us, it is hypochlorite. It will give us chloride and chlorates. Next, we have halous acids. So halous acids, the general formula is HXO2. For chlorine, it will be HClO2. Only halous acid known for known is the chlorous acid. So that is why we are discussing here directly about the chlorous acid. So it is prepared from the barium salt of the, or we can say barium chloride. We'll take barium chloride, we treat it with H2SO4, we get the precipitation of barium sulfate, and along with that we'll get the formation of HClO2, that is chlorous acid. So it is unstable, it disproportionates and it acts as an oxidant. So its disproportionation reaction will give us the corresponding hypochlorous acid and chloric acid. So the chlorides are also decomposed to corresponding chlorides and chlorates, the corresponding salts of these two acids. So next we have halic acids. So acidic strength of halic acids also vary with the decreases with the decrease in electronegativity of the central atom. So first one we have the chloric acid. So it is prepared by treating barium chlorate with sulfuric acid. Again, we'll get the formation of chloric acid here. So it disproportionates to perchlorate and chloride. It is powerful oxidizing as well as bleaching agent. It decomposes to give chloride and oxygen at high temperature. And at high temperature, it will give us perchlorates and chlorides. So this is the kind of reaction it gives. Next, we have bromic acid. The next helic acid is bromic acid. It is also prepared from the corresponding barium salt of barium bromide, we can say. Barium bromide will react with H2SO4, will get the precipitation for barium sulfate and will get the corresponding bromic acid. So it is also used as oxidizing agent. It can oxidize H2S2 sulfur and SO2, that is sulfur dioxide, to H2SO4. Next, we have iodic acid, that is HIO3. It is prepared by the treatment of iodine with nitric acid, will get the formation of iodic acid. And this iodic acid, upon heating, it will give us I2O5, which is its anhydride, which is I2O5 is the anhydride of HIO3. So anhydrides, we can easily, I didn't discuss about the anhydrides for these acids, because generally these gives oxides. These acids are obtained in mixture by treating, removing the water. So yes, they share their anhydrides. So the HIO3 is having the anhydride as I2O5. So it is good oxidizing agent. It is strong, which is stronger than H2O2. So it will react with H2O2 and it will get this kind of reaction. So oxygen will be released, I2 will be released, and water, and further I2 will react with H2O2 and will get the formation of this again, that is HIO3. Next, we have perhelic acid. First one is perchloric acid. It is very strong acid, strongest among the mineral acids which are known. So it is perchloric acid. So it is obtained by the distillation of chloric acid under reduced pressure. We'll get this perchloric acid. The corresponding salts are perchlorates. So it can also be prepared from perchlorate by treating them with H2SO4 under reduced pressure. So its properties are, it decomposes upon heating with explosion to the corresponding chlorides. And with the dehydrating agent, it will give us corresponding anhydride, that is Cl2O7. Its cold aqueous acid forms chlorates with many metals. So with metals, it will give us corresponding salts, that is perchlorates, which are thermally stable. This is the perbromate. These are prepared by the electrolysis of bromates. Next, we have periodic acid. So for iodic acids, for periodic acids, we have four series of periodic acids. This is kind of important part here, that we have four series of periodic acid with the formula this here. Iodine is in plus 7 oxidation state in all, but the basic formula is changing. This is first one is HIO4, which is metaperiodic acid. Then we have H4I2O9, which is dimesoperiodic acid. Then we have H3IO5, which is mesoperiodic acid. In the last, we have H5IO6, which is para-periodic acids. So these acids, as well as the corresponding salts, are the powerful oxidizing agents. And the first and the last one, these are the most stable, that is para and the meta form. So these can be interconverted by these reactions. So these can be prepared by HIO4, which is meta. It can be prepared by heating the para-periodic acid in vacuum. So this is how this can be prepared. This para-periodic acid, it can be prepared by this reaction treating the corresponding salt with the sulfuric acid. So this is how it can be prepared. And these, all the acids can be interconverted by the temperature changing reactions. So this is the kind of interchange reactions. So the structure of para is this. Iodine is having this octahedral structure. This is having octahedral structure with 5 OH groups and 1 of the doubly bonded oxygen. So if we talk about the relative acidic strength of oxoacids, relative acidic strength decreases as we are moving down the group for acids. And also it increases with increase in the number of doubly bonded oxygens. And as the number of OH groups is same, so the acidic strength increases with increase in doubly bonded oxygen as oxidation state is increasing, which leads to the increase in oxidation state and which leads to increase in acidic strength. So the basic properties of halogens, these all are highly electronegative and possess high ionization energy. So they all have non-metallic character. So the non-metallic character decreases down the group and electronegativity also decreases down the group and ionization energy is also and ionization energy decrease as observed from the metallic luster. So many compounds are there where halogens except of fluorine form cations. So as we are moving down the group, there is a chance that halogens are making their cations as ionization energy is also decreasing down the group. So there's a possible for them to behave. There's a possibility for the lower members to behave as cations. So there are evidences and there are compounds where the halogens have been forming the cations. So these compounds are called as interhalogen compounds. One of the example is interhalogen compounds where both the cation and the anionic part of the compound is served by the halogen family. So the cation would also, but the only condition is cation would always be less electronegative and the corresponding more electronegative would going to serve the anionic part. So the driving force for the formation of these interhalogen compounds is the large variation in their size and their electronegativities. So these are some of the examples of well-known interhalogen compounds. So these are the examples that AX here, A is the cationic part and X is the anionic part. So here these compounds are known in plus one oxidation state, plus three, plus five, plus seven. And these are the examples, actual examples of these interhalogen compounds, CLF, CLF3, CLF5, BRF, BRF3, BRF5. IF is quite unstable. IF3 is quite unstable. The more stable ones are the IF5, IF7. So now coming to the preparation reactions, these can be prepared directly by the reaction of these two halogen gases with each other by taking them at different temperatures, pressures, and in different ratios. So yes, they can be prepared by this method with the general formula AX, then AX3 and AX5. So these can be prepared. Also AX7 at high temperature, at some temperature of 250 to 300 degrees Celsius, IF7 can be prepared. So this second method for their preparation is they can be treated, the lower interhalogen compounds can be treated with the halogen itself and will get them in higher oxidation state. So this is how these three type of halogens can, these three categories of interhalogen compounds can be prepared. So these are also prepared from the salts of metal. If we treat with the metal halides with the corresponding the other halogens and we get these kind of interhalogen compounds. So if we talk about the general properties of interhalogen compounds, they are having polar as both the members of the both the members, that is the cation and the anion, belong to the halogen family. So they both are non-metals. So they in general form the covalent compounds, but due to their electronegativity difference, existing electronegativity difference in between these two members of the same group, the sum of the polar nature is there. They possess polarity in their compounds. Physical state, they exist in all the three physical states. Some are gases, some are liquids, and some are solids also. If we talk about melting points and boiling points, so melting points and boiling points depends upon the electronegativity difference in the two bonded halogens. More is the difference, more is going to be the melting points and the boiling points. For reactivity, they exhibit similar reactivity as they're from the constituents which they have been generated. But yes, they are more reactive due to covalent bond in the two dissimilar halogens. Because there is a covalent bonding in between the similar halogens, this is the cationic part, this is the anionic part. But here, there is a covalent bond between the two dissimilar halogens. So yes, these are more reactive. Interhalogen compounds are more reactive than their corresponding halogens out of which they have been generated. So interhalogen compounds of fluorine are powerful fluorinating agent. Here we are discussing some of their properties and some of their applications. So these can convert the metal oxides, fluorides to the corresponding fluorides. So here we have shown the fluorinating action of the fluorides of interhalogen compounds. So this is how fluorination can be done. Next, we have ionization of interhalogen compounds. These exhibit good conductance in solutions or fused form, which suggests that they undergo autoionization reactions. So ICL autoionizes as I positive and ICL2 negative. ICL3 autoionizes as ICL2 positive, ICL4 negative. Similar is of these two compounds. So they undergo autoionization and exist in ionic states. Now, if we talk about their magnetism, all the interhalogen compounds, interhalogen molecules, which are neutral, they are, and their uninegative interhalogen ions, they all are diamagnetic in nature. Why they are diamagnetic? Because total number of halogen atoms in this neutral molecule, in these type of neutral molecule, is even. So if even number of atoms are there, that means even number of electrons are there. That means all the electrons are paired of that, which means these are diamagnetic in nature. These are all are strong oxidizing agents. They undergo hydrolysis to give the corresponding hydrolysis products, where cation is going to attach with the OH and the anionic part is going to attach with the hydrogen. If we talk about the thermal stability increases with increase in electronegativity difference in between the cation and the anionic part. So these are some of the compounds where electronegativity difference have been shown, and their stability order is in alliance with the increase in electronegativity, stability is increasing. Now let us have a look at the structure of interhalogen compounds. So firstly, we are discussing about the AX type. So example is ClF. So the electronic configuration, this is the ground state. This is going to be, it is having three lone pairs and one of the orbital is having one single electron, which is going to make bond with the single electron of fluorine. So that means this is sp3 hybridized with three lone pairs and one bond pair. So sp3 hybridization with tetrahedral geometry and with normal shape, as it is a bond between two atoms. AX3, they are going to be sp3 dehybridization. Pragonal bipyramidal is going to be geometry and shape is going to be T shape for this, because there are two lone pairs and three bond pairs. Out of these, ICL3, it exists in its crystalline form as a dimer with planar structure. So there are such kind of exceptions also. Next, we have AX5. From here, if we calculate the value of Z to have an overview of the hybridization, it comes out to be sp3d2, which suggests octahedral geometry. That means the five groups and one lone pair are making the octahedral geometry. That means the shape is going to be square pyramidal. Next, we have AX7. So Z comes out to be 7 itself. Geometry is going to be, and hybridization is going to be sp3d3, and geometry is going to be pentagonal bipyramidal. Next, we have interhalogen ions and polyhalides. So in addition to the neutral interhalogen compounds, a large number of interhalogen cations, anions, and polyhalide ions are known. So these are formed by the self-dissociation, as we have already mentioned about their self-dissociation at ICL3, we have already discussed, BRF3 already discussed, that they undergo autoionization to give the corresponding cations and the anions. Also, they exist in the form of polyhalides. Mostly, most common one is I3 negative. So it is obtained by the dissolution of I2 when it is dissolved in the solution of Ki. So this is dissolved due to the formation of this I3 negative anion. So for a given cation, symmetrical interhalogen anions are more stable than unsymmetrical one. So stability increases with increase in size of the central atom. For such kind of ions, for any cation, and the anion which is symmetrical is going to be more stable, and where the central atom and the stability increases further with increase in central atom, size of the central atom. So here, if we talk about the structure of these interhalogen compounds, so in the same way we can have their hybridization, we can calculate the value of Z based upon the formula, and we'll have this hybridization, and we'll get to know the number of bond pairs and number of lone pairs, and we'll get to know the hybridization and corresponding shape of the molecule. So these are few examples of the interhalogen cations and the anions. Next, we have SN compounds, which is one of the important compounds out of the group 16 elements. So this is the last topic out of our syllabus. So this we are going to discuss in our next video. So that is it for this video. Thank you so much. Have a good rest of the day.